portion of the sidewalk gave way in front of a nail salon and a barber shop on East 4th Street this morning. Firefighters cordoned off the area after a person fell into the hole, landing in the building's basement. The injured pedestrian was rushed to the hospital. No word yet on the extent of that person's injuries. The Department of Buildings ordered a partial vacate order for the two stores and issued a summons for failure to maintain the building up to code.
Pavement light. Pavement lights in the UK, vault lights in the US, floor lights or sidewalk prisms are flat-topped walk-on skylights, usually set into pavement or sidewalks or floors to let sunlight into the space below. They often use anodic lighting prisms to throw the light sideways under the building. They were developed in the 19th century but declined in popularity with the advent of cheap electric lighting. Older cities and smaller centers around the world have or have had pavement lights. Most such lights are approximately a century old, although lights are being installed in some new construction. Uses. Sidewalk prisms are a method of daylighting basements and are able to serve as a sole source of illumination during the day. At night, lighting in the basements beneath produces a glowing sidewalk. Vault lights may be used to make subterranean space useful. They are more common in city centers, dense, high-rent areas where space is valuable. Historically, landlords took an interest in improving only the floor area ratio, but the amount of space that was naturally lit on the grounds that this was profitable. Occupiers valued daylight not only as a way of saving on artificial lighting costs, which were higher historically, but also as a way to let premises remain cooler in summer, and a way to save on ventilation costs if using gas lighting rather than arc lamps or early incandescent lights. Pavement lights and related products were historically marketed as a way of saving on artificial lighting costs and making space more usable and pleasant. Modern studies of similar daylighting technology provide evidence for those claims. Vault lights are also used in floors under glass roofs, for example, on Budapest's historic Parisi Udvar and New York's mostly demolished old Pennsylvania station. Vault lights could also be set into the basement floor underneath other vault lights, creating a double-deck arrangement, which would light the sub-basement. Manhole covers and coal hole covers with lighting elements were also made. History. A basement that extends below a sidewalk or pavement is called an areaway, a sidewalk vault, or a hollow sidewalk. In some cities, these areaways were created by the raising of the street level to combat floods, and in some cases, they form an often now abandoned tunnel network. To light these spaces, sidewalks incorporated gratings, which were a trip hazard and let water and street dirt as well as light into the basement. Replacing the open gratings with glass was an obvious improvement. Frames. Sidewalk prisms developed from deck prisms, which were used to let light through the decks of ships. The earliest pavement light, Rockwell, 1834, used a single large round glass lens set in an iron frame. The large lens was directly exposed to traffic, and if the lens broke, a large hole was left in the pavement, which was potentially unsafe for pedestrians. Thaddeus Hyatt corrected these faults with his Hyatt light of 1854. Many small lenses, bullseyes, were set in a wrought iron frame, later cast iron, and the frame included raised nubs around each lens to improve traction in wet weather and to protect them from damage and wear. Even if all of the lenses were broken out, the panel would still be safe to walk on. In the 1930s, London authorities ruled that glass sections could not be larger than 100 millimeters by 100 millimeters. Modern glass floors are made of laminated and toughened glass pavers, which can be substantially larger. They have an upper protective layer that can be replaced if it becomes chipped or cracked. The top surface of the pavers may also be chosen and treated to improve traction. Wrought iron, cast iron, and stainless steel frames have all been used. Reinforced concrete slabs began to replace iron frames in the 1890s New York. Benefits claimed included less condensation and a less slippery surface when wet. Concrete panels may be precast or cast in situ. Late concrete panels often were made with metal-framed armored prisms, which were intended to prevent breakage and make replacing individual prisms easier. The glass is not cast into the concrete, but caulked into the frame. Rather than chiseling out the old glass, the glass can be popped out of the frame. Translucent concrete has also been proposed as a floor material. This would essentially make it a vault light with a very small fiber optic lighting element. It also innately redirects the light from the angle of incidence to an angle parallel to the optical fibers, usually perpendicular to the surface of the concrete. Transparent elements. The transparent elements may be referred to as prisms or lenses depending on the shape, or as jewels. Glass color. The glass in many old pavement lights is now either purple or straw colored. This is a side effect of the manufacturing process. Pure silica glass is transparent, but older glass manufacturers often use silica from sand, which contains iron and other impurities. Iron produces a greenish tint in the finished glass. To remove this effect, a decolorizer such as manganese dioxide, glassmaker's soap, was added during the manufacture of the glass. When exposed to ultraviolet light, the manganese slowly solarizes, turning purple, which is why many existing sidewalk prisms are now purple. World War I increased demand for manganese in the United States and cut off the supply of high-grade ore from Germany. So selenium dioxide was used as a decolorizer instead. Selenium also solarizes, but to a straw color. Replacement glass that has been tinted purple deliberately in order to match the current color has been used in some historic restoration projects. Glass shape. In 1871, London, Hayward Brothers patented their semi-prism, changing the shape of the glass by adding pendant prisms to the underside, reflects the light sideways, allowing it to light the area under the main building. The pendant shapes were right angle or half prisms, which reflected all incoming light sideways. The horizontal ridges protruding from the top of the prism let it be set into an opening in an iron or cement grating. Some cast glass pendant prisms have flat portions to shed light directly below, as well as throwing it sideways under the main body of the building. Some prisms were made with multiple pendant prisms, either as a Fresnel lens-like sheet of identical prisms, or a sheet of dissimilar prisms that could distribute the light. The precise angles at which prisms refracted or reflected light was important. An installation would generally consist of multiple different prescriptions of prism, chosen either by an on-site expert contractor or by a layman using standard algorithms. This would also diffuse the light somewhat, as would the rough glass surfaces. Larger castings are more expensive, not only because they use more glass, but because they take longer to cool. Modern glass floors use laminate sheet glass through some centimeters, more than an inch, thick. It is often transparent. Non-glass translucent materials. Synthetic resin composites, such as fiberglass, as well as plastics, such as Lexan, have been proposed to replace missing prism lights. Translucent decking panels are made of fiberglass, often used for balconies, which would otherwise shade the windows below them. Peel and stick prism films recently have come on the market with acrylic microprisms that internally reflect light, somewhat like glass pendant prisms. Structure. In some cases, a second vertical curtain of prisms was installed under the building sill. These were analogous to the prism transoms used over above-ground windows and doors. The light could be bent in two stages and used to daylight the whole basement. The areaway under a sidewalk light usually has a masonry wall separating it from the soil under the street, although it may extend partly under the street. Support for the vault light frames varies. Steel crossbeams supported by columns are common in older buildings. Metal decks are common in newer ones. Current state and trends. Manufacture, maintenance, and repair. Some modern pavement lights are quite different from historic ones, so restoration and replacement may use different techniques and parts. A few companies now manufacture and sell vault lights either as glass-only prefab panels or installation. Construction methods and prices vary widely. Historically, glass lenses were standardized by each manufacturer. Some modern manufacturers produce standardized prisms. Some firms also supply replacement glass castings to order. Cost varies greatly. Shapes needing complicated articulated molds are more expensive. Modern caulking materials are used for caulking in replacement glass. Broken and damaged frames can be repatched, rewelded, or recast. Generally speaking, restoration requires only simple tools and technology. Promptly repairing sidewalk cracks and avoiding de-icers that will corrode metal helps keep the supporting structure dry and in good repair. Keeping a sidewalk light watertight does not cost much in time or materials. Vaults generally last many decades, and many extant vaults are more than a century old. Reuse and preservation. Despite their reusability and repairability, old panels are often landfilled. However, the City of Victoria, Canada, is stockpiling removed pavement light panels for future restoration projects. Often, individual broken sidewalk prisms are not replaced, but instead the opening is filled with concrete or other opaque materials, such as metal, wood, and asphalt. When a building is renovated, vault lights may be removed or concreted over. For instance, the floor of New York's mostly demolished Old Pennsylvania Station was made of vault lights to let through the concourse floor onto the platforms. The undersides of the lights can still be seen, but the tops have been concreted over. While some cities have preservation measures for vault lights, others actively remove them and fill areaways. Sometimes the outside appearance of the lights is retained while filling the areaway and setting the lights in a concrete pad, removing their daylighting function. Some areaways are mothballed, that is, filled with gravel that could be removed later. Areaways are used in some cities as a convenient place to run utilities, which may make the cities reluctant to give areaways legal protection. In some cases, utility construction leads to areaways being filled. Load-bearing strength. The load-bearing strength of vault lights varies widely with span, construction, and state of repair. Some damaged vaults may not be able to support a fire engine, which a sidewalk vault in sound condition should be able to do. Many jurisdictions do not have regulations on the load-bearing capacity of pavement lights, and manufacturers may develop their own loading standards in compliance with local fire department regulations. The load-bearing capacity of pavement lights can be tested, and lights can be designed and built to specific load-bearing capacities. Damp areaways may corrode the steel load-bearing elements supporting the pavement roof. Moisture may come from leakage from above or from groundwater from below.
There's plenty of cracks going on here.
Walk at your own risk.
You can see where, you know, if a woman stepped on that with a high heel.
This section of downtown Stockton sidewalk doubles as a minefield of misfortune.
We had problems with people stealing parking meters. We just ripped out the whole pole when they stole the parking meter.
They stole the parking meter.
Correct.
And no one ever covered up the hole.
Correct.
Jacob Benguerel owns two businesses on this Stockton street.
Just seeing this decay scares people away.
Avoiding holes, cracks, and crumbling concrete makes for a bit of a maze for pedestrians.
In some spots where the sidewalk holes are so big they're dangerous, the city has put these orange cones on top of them. But they still haven't fixed them.
Benguerel says he emailed the city public works department with a list of complaints, but received a letter back reading city code requires the sidewalk problems be fixed by building property owners.
My response was to point out that they are the building owner and the property owner. Most of these buildings are owned by them.
After that,
crickets. I haven't heard anything back.
A Stockton City spokesperson tells CBS 13 they are now aware of Benguerel's complaints and are now, quote, working through them. That many sidewalk holes require the help of other agencies like utility companies.
You have nice sidewalks, nice downtown. I think you're going to attract more people who are feel safer just by the fact that everything is well maintained.
Concern over eyesore sidewalks from a business owner banking his future here, asking his city to do better.
Prism lighting. Prism lighting is the use of prisms to improve the distribution of light in a space. It is usually used to distribute daylight and is a form of anodic lighting. Prism lighting was popular from its introduction in the 1890s through to the 1930s, when cheap electric lights were commonplace and prism lighting became unfashionable. While mass production of prism lighting systems ended around 1940, the 2010s have seen a revival using new materials. How it works. The human eye's response to light is nonlinear. Cutting in half the light level does not cut in half the perceived brightness of a space. It only makes it look slightly dimmer. If light is redistributed from the brightest parts of a room to the dimmest, the room therefore appears brighter overall, and more space can be given a useful and comfortable level of illumination. This can reduce the need for artificial lighting. Refraction and total internal reflection inside optical prisms can bend beams of light. This bending of the light allows it to be redistributed. Many small prisms may be joined at the edges into a sheet. A prism sheet is somewhat like a linear Fresnel lens, but each ridge may be identical. Unlike a Fresnel lens, the light is not intended to be focused, but used for anodic lighting. Types. Deck prisms carried light through the upper decks of ships and spread it in the decks below. Similarly on land, prisms and sidewalk lights were used to light basements and vaults. Prism tiles were used vertically, usually as a transom light above a window or door. They were also built into fixed and movable canopies, sloped glazing, and skylights. They bend light upwards so that it penetrates more deeply into the room, rather than lighting the floor near the window. Modern prismatic panels are essentially an acrylic version of the old glass prism tiles. Like glass tiles, they can be mounted on adjustable canopies. Channel panels use slits that reflect light internally. Holographic optical elements can also be used to redirect light. Daylight redirecting window film, or DRF, is a thin, flexible peel-and-stick sheet with the optical layer generally made of acrylic. There are two types of film. Some is molded with tiny prisms, making a flexible peel and stick miniature prismatic panel. Other film is molded with thin near horizontal voids protruding into or through the acrylic. The slits reflect light hitting their top surfaces upwards. Refraction is minimized to avoid coloring the light. The reflection-based films are more transparent, but they tend to send the light up at the ceiling, not deeper into the room. Refraction-based films are translucent rather than transparent, but offer finer control over the direction of the outgoing light beam. The film can be made in a variety of prism shapes to reflect light by a variety of angles. manufacture, and repair. Older glass elements were cast and might be cut and polished. Prism tiles were often made of single prisms joined with zinc, lead, or electroglazed copper strips, rather like the methods used to join traditional European stained glass. Sidewalk prisms were cast in one piece as single or multiple prism lenses and inserted into load-bearing frames. Daylight redirecting film is made of acrylic. Damaged prism tiles may be repaired, and as they came in standard designs, there is a salvage market in replacements. Replacements for one-piece castings can be commissioned. Weakened prism tiles may be reinforced with hidden bars, much like those used to reinforce stained glass. Sophisticated systems for lighting different sorts of spaces with prism tiles were developed. Generally, the goal was said to send available light across the room nearly horizontally. One company sold tiles with 9 prescriptions, giving different angles of refraction. Different prescriptions were often used in different parts of the same window transom, sometimes to disperse the light vertically and sometimes to bend light horizontally around obstacles like pillars. Prism tiles sometimes had elaborate artistic designs molded into the outside. Frank Lloyd Wright famously created over 40 prism tile designs. Prism lighting works more effectively in light open spaces. Some believe that it contributed to the trend away from dark, subdivided Victorian interiors to open-plan light-colored ones. The removal of covering of old prism transom lights often leaves characteristically tall signage spaces over shop windows. Daylight redirecting window film was initially made of one redirecting film and one glare-reducing diffusing film, often located on different interior surfaces of a double glazed window, but integrated single films are now available. Some daylight redirecting films reflect incoming light upwards off tiny near horizontal reflectors, so at high sun angles bend it sharply, throwing it upwards to the ceiling, where a typical ceiling diffuses the daylight somewhat deeper into the space. Other daylight redirecting films refract light at any specified angle, ideally sending it nearly horizontally into the room. Redirecting films can be used as a substitute for opaque blinds. Deck prism. A deck prism is a prism inserted into the deck of a ship to provide light below. For centuries, sailing ships used deck prisms to provide a safe source of natural sunlight to illuminate areas below decks. Before electricity, light below a vessel's deck was provided by candles, oil, and kerosene lamps, all dangerous aboard a wooden ship. The deck prism laid flush into the deck. The glass prism refracted and dispersed natural light into the space below from a small deck opening without weakening the planks or becoming a fire hazard. In normal usage, the prism hangs below the overhead and disperses the light sideways. The top is flat and installed flush with the deck, becoming part of the deck. The lens shapes were naturally derived from the process of hand-making the glass on an iron and would have predated the ability to manufacture flat glass. A plain flat glass window would just form a single bright spot below, not very useful for general illumination, hence the prismatic shape. To maximize light output, the glass used was originally made colorless with the addition of manganese dioxide. The purple hue of some specimens is caused by decades of exposure to UV. Aboard colliers, which were coal ships, prisms were also used to keep check on the cargo hold. Light from a fire would be collected by the prism and be made visible on the deck even in daylight. The names deck light, dead light, or dead light are sometimes used, though the latter is uncommon as a reference to prisms, as more often refers to non-opening plain glass panels. Dead lights were commonplace for lighting underground vaults in the 19th century, which application they were also called pavement lights in the UK or vault lights in the United States. Thaddeus Hyatt. Thaddeus Hyatt, born July 21, 1816, and died July 25, 1901, was an American abolitionist and inventor. In his opposition to slavery, Hyatt organized the efforts of abolitionists in Kansas to have the territory admitted to the Union as a free state and campaigned for the federal government to aid Kansas afflicted by drought. Hyatt befriended John Brown and provided Brown with financial support. Following the raid on Harper's Ferry, Hyatt was investigated by a committee of the United States Senate. When Hyatt refused to comply with a congressional subpoena and cooperate with the Senate investigation, the Senate voted to jail the recalcitrant abolitionist. As an inventor, Hyatt was a wealthy man profiting from his invention of iron and glass vault covers for admitting sunlight to spaces below sidewalks and pavements. Hyatt also innovated and patented several designs for reinforced concrete floors. Anodolic lighting. Anodolic lighting systems use anodolic optical components to light rooms. Light redirected by these systems does not converge to a focal point or form an image. Anodolic lighting uses non-imaging mirrors, lenses, and light guides to capture exterior sunlight and direct it deeply into rooms, while also scattering rays to avoid glare. The human eye's response to light is nonlinear, so a more even distribution of the same amount of light makes a room appear brighter. It is most challenging to effectively capture and redistribute light on a cloudy, overcast day when the sunlight is diffuse. Optical elements. Mirrors are typically parabolic or elliptical mirrors. Lenses are frequently made in multiple sections, like a Fresnel lens. Light guides include light pipes and anodolic ceilings. Lens systems. Lens systems use reflection and refraction within optical prisms to redirect daylight. Some forms of prism lighting have been used for centuries, and others are 21st century. Deck prisms were set into the upper decks of ships to light the decks below. Pavement lights were set into floors or sidewalks to let light into a basement below. The underside was frequently extended into prisms to direct and spread the light. Prism tiles were designed to bend some beams coming through a window upwards so that they would reach deeper into a room. They were placed in the upper parts of window frames where they were called transom lights. Daylight redirecting window film, or DRF, is a thin, flexible plastic version of the old glass prism tiles. It can be used as a substitute for opaque blinds. Mirror systems. Anodolic mirror lighting systems can be divided into three parts: daylight capture, usually with zenithal light collector; optimal transmission of the light via anodolic ceilings, light tubes, etc.; distribution of captured light to target areas inside the rooms. Architectural design also requires optimal integration into the building facade. Collection. Typically, light is captured with a compound parabolic collector, CPC, or elliptical collector, CEC, mounted on the exterior wall. These mirrors provide a wide and even collection pattern. The vertical capture angle approaches 90 degrees from the horizon to the vertical plane of the supporting wall. An even capture pattern alleviates the need for a solar tracker. A permanently fixed anodolic collector remains effective at any time of day. External parabolic collectors require proper heat insulation, usually double glazed windows over the zenithal opening, and roller blinds to reduce excessive lighting, glare, and heat on sunny days. Snow and weatherproofing are also a consideration. Transmission. Unlike the industrial parabolic troughs used in solar concentrators, architectural CPC mirrors do not concentrate captured light into a single focal point or focal line, which creates a fire hazard. Instead, light is directed into the building through a relatively wide opening. Distribution. A second CPC or CEC mirror acting as an angle transformer disperses this beam into a wide-angle diffused pattern. If it transmits light from a wide external CPC, a light tube actually becomes a flat anodolic ceiling. Architectural integration. Integrated anodolic systems reduce external protrusion and attempt to visually blend into traditional facades. However, like other anodolic systems, they are susceptible to glare and offer no protection from overheating on sunny days. Seattle Underground. The Seattle Underground is a network of underground passageways and basements in downtown Pioneer Square, Seattle, Washington, in the United States, that were at ground level when the city was built in the mid-19th century. After the streets were elevated, these spaces fell into disuse, but have become a tourist attraction in recent decades. After the streets were elevated? History. After the Great Seattle Fire of June 6, 1889, new construction was required to be of masonry, and the town streets were regraded 1 to 2 stories higher. Pioneer Square had originally been built mostly on filled-in tidelands and often flooded. The new street level also kept sewers draining into Elliott Bay from backing up at high tide. For the regrade, the streets were lined with concrete walls that formed narrow alleyways between the walls and the buildings on both sides of the street, with a wide alley where the street was. I wonder what that looked like. The naturally steep hillsides were used, and through a series of sluices, material was washed into the wide alleys, raising the streets to the new desired level, generally 12 feet or 3.7 meters higher than before, in some places nearly 30 feet or 9.1 meters higher. Okay. At first, pedestrians climbed ladders to go between street level and sidewalks in front of the building entrances. Brick archways were constructed next to the road surface, above the submerged sidewalks. Pavement lights, a form of walk-on skylight with panes of clear glass which later became amethyst colored, were installed over the gap from the raised street and the building, creating the area now called the Seattle Underground. When they reconstructed their buildings, merchants and landlords knew that the ground floor would eventually be underground, and the next floor up would be the new ground floor. So there is very little decoration on the doors and windows of the original ground floor, but extensive decoration on the new ground floor. Once the new sidewalks were complete, building owners moved their businesses to the new ground floor, although merchants carried on business in the lowest floors of buildings that survived the fire, and pedestrians continued to use the underground sidewalks lit by the pavement lights, still seen on some streets, embedded in the grade level sidewalk above. In 1907, the city condemned the underground for fear of bubonic plague. 2 years before the 1909 World Fair in Seattle, the Alaska-Yukon-Pacific Exposition, the basements were left to deteriorate or were used as storage. Some became illegal flop houses for the homeless, gambling halls, speakeasies, and opium dens. Only a small portion of the Seattle Underground has been restored and made safe and accessible to the public on guided tours. Popular culture. The Seattle Underground was featured prominently in the 1973 television movie The Night Strangler, starring Darren McGavin. The film was a sequel to the 1972 TV movie The Night Stalker and brought a surge in tourism to the underground afterward. The movie was not filmed in the underground, as the area available was small. Filming was in the Bradbury Building and in a Universal Studios soundstage. The 25th Terry Pratchett novel in the Discworld series, The Truth, mentions that the fictional capital city of Ankh, A-N-K-H, Morpork, M-O-R-P-O-R-K, is built on lower foundations made of Ankh Morpork, and that after significant flooding of the river Ankh, the streets were gradually raised one level, starting with the road, and people used ladders and bridges to cross the street in the appendix Pratchett makes reference to the strangeness of reality as found in Seattle, Washington.
Thank you.
All of the examples in this video are provided as evidence as to why you might live in a mudflood city if your location has things like pavement, prism, vault, floor, and sidewalk lights, coal hole covers, and ventilation hitching posts.